Good morning, everyone. One had a great game last night. All right. Who'd have thought they'd beat the Hail Mary? And the Hail Mary got beat. Anyway. Welcome to Union Phoenix. My name is Richard Mirage. I'm the senior minister here. It's great to see you all, and welcome.
I'm Richard Rogers, and I lead the Wednesday night service around here.
All right. Do you? Really?
Is that my part?
Yes, I believe it
is. Okay, this is my part. Our intention for you today is that you have a profound experience of God and that you be inspired to live your greatest possible life. Are you interested?
All right.
That's what we're about.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel God's mighty power and God's grace. I can feel the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. And I invite you right now just to close your eyes and take a deep breath and just open your heart to God. And as best as you can, just set aside all of the things that you're concerned about. All the responsibilities, all the activities. And just let them go. Let go of anything that is holding you back from giving God your undivided attention. And just take another deep breath. And just let it go. And feel your body relaxing. Feel your thoughts slowing down. And feel your attention turning away from the outer world into that inner world. To that place deep within you, where all the storms are calmed, where all of our hurts are healed, where all of our questions are answered, where all the cloudiness becomes clear. Everyone, just take another deep breath into that and fully immerse yourself in the living, loving Spirit of God. And just let God's love wash over you, cleansing, relaxing, renewing and refreshing you in mind, body, and spirit. For it truly is the Father's good pleasure to give us the kingdom. Just know that God isn't withholding anything from you. What God delights and desires in flowing into your life, all the love, all the peace, all the joy, all the wisdom, all the goodness and blessings that you are willing to receive. So again, take another deep breath and open yourself to receive and to allow the love and the fullness and the peace and the beauty of God to flow into your life. And just know that the more you open your heart to God, the less you have to struggle and fight. The more you can let go, the more you could live your life with ease and grace. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest." So for the next few moments, let's just rest in the awareness of the living, loving Spirit of God, knowing that all things are working together for our highest good. For that is God's will and desire. So for the next few moments, let's sit in the silence and let God minister to you in exactly the way that your heart and your life needs. Just let go and let God. If peace. Be still. That we've allowed our hearts to be ministered to by that living Spirit of God. Let us not turn our thoughts and prayers to our loved ones. If you have a family member or a friend, a neighbor or a co-worker in need of healing or prayer or guidance, I invite you to bring them into your heart right now. And to each of these beloved souls, we just affirm that the healing power of God is working in and through them right now, that they are being healed and transformed, comforted, guided in exactly the way that they need for the highest and best outcome. For each of these beautiful souls, we affirm the greatest prayer we could ever pray, and that prayer is God's will be done. For God's will is greater than, higher than anything we can even hold for ourselves. So as we bring this time of prayer and meditation to an end, I invite you to remember the feeling you're feeling right now. I know that this same feeling of peace, the same feeling of connection and oneness is always with us. For God is closer to our hands and feet and nearer than our very breath. So we give thanks in advance for all the prayers, the answered prayers, all the blessings in our lives, and we give thanks for the even greater things still to come. And we pray this all through the name and the power of the living Christ Spirit. And so it is. Amen.
Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory.
Today we celebrate Dr. Martin Luther King. and our civil rights holiday. And I love the fact that we have a day in this country where we celebrate our civil rights. Because most of the time when it comes to civil rights, they're often taken for granted until the day when you don't have them. And then everybody says, well, what happened here? Where'd that go? And in our country, we are in a critical time of celebrating and acknowledging our civil rights. And what are the things that we've agreed upon apply to all people? Today we celebrate that we are a nation of the people, and Dr. King's vision that all people are equal under the law. Our nation was founded on the idea that we the people, and over the last 240 years, that definition of we has expanded greatly. 240 years ago, there was a clear understanding of who we was, and it didn't include everyone. And over the last 240 years, our definition continues to grow and expand with the idea that as a country, we will not stop, we will not rest until we truly is all of us. And Dr. King's most profound idea that sometimes gets the least amount of play and understanding is the idea that King had about the beloved community. King's idea of the beloved community was a community that worked for all. He was committed to this idea that we could not stop, we could not rest until we had created a society that everyone was being equally blessed. Reading from the King's Center. The beloved community was not a lofty utopian goal to be confused with a rapturous image of a peaceful kingdom where lions and lambs coexist in idyllic harmony, but rather the beloved community was a realistic, achievable goal that could be attained by a critical mass of people committed and trained in the philosophy and the methods of nonviolence. Dr. King's beloved community was a global vision which all people could share in the wealth of the earth. In the beloved community, poverty, hunger, homelessness would not be tolerated because the international standard of human dignity and decency would not allow it. Racism in all of its forms of discrimination, bigotry, and prejudices would be replaced by an all-inclusive spirit of sisterhood and brotherhood. In the beloved community, the international disputes would be resolved with peaceful conflict resolution, and conflict would be understood instead of using military power. Love and trust would replace fear and hatred. Peace and justice would prevail over war and military conflict. In a 1966 article in the Christian Century magazine, King is recorded as saying, "I do not think that political power is an end. Neither do I believe that economic power is an end. They are ingredients in the objective that we seek in life. And I think the end is the objective of truly a brotherly society, the creation of the beloved community." It's been exactly 50 years since King gave that quote. And so my question for you today is, how do you think we're doing? I mean, 50 years later, 50 years. It's no small amount of time. It's been 50 years since he gave that quote. So how do you think we're doing? How do you think we're doing creating a society, a community that works for all? Are we on the mark? Have we crossed the line? Are we celebrating our happy dance that we all won? Or have we occasionally missed the mark? Because in the last 50 years, things have changed. We have moved forward. There are differences now in our society that were not in place in 1966. But it has been 50 years. And often we've grown asleep to the real challenges that we have in our society. Because the thing that we sometimes don't want to acknowledge is that we really do have control over what we become. We can go to sleep to that power, but the truth is, we truly have control over what we are. We get to decide. We get to make whatever reality we choose to live in a reality. King was a visionary leader. He was. He had a dream. He saw a possibility of what could be, and he enrolled people into that possibility in a way that encouraged them to change their behavior so that that dream could become a reality. Is that true? It's true. And the truth is, for all of us, that all of us are being asked to be visionary leaders. That we are not here just to go along with what is, but we are here to really listen to what's in our heart and our soul of what could be and say, what actions can I take today that would move our world forward in a world that would work for all? See, some want to believe that it's not possible. Some want to say that we can't truly get there, so we just need to make peace with what is. But the reality is, if we don't move forward, there's a line in a lecture that King gave at ASU in 1964. And until recently, no one had a recording of it. And they found it somebody had given a box of reel-to-reel tapes. Richard shared this with me, and Vern shared it with you. And in it was a lecture that King gave at ASU. And in it he said, we are either going to learn to live as brothers, or we're going to perish together as fools. It's true. So today, the question that I place before you is, to what extent are you willing to be a visionary leader in your life? And what extent are you willing to have a vision of what could be in your life, in your community, in your job, in your family, and to be willing to be a voice of what could be? Because there really are three ingredients that show up when we're a visionary leader. The first one is, a visionary leader helps people see what is. Now, you think that would be easy, right? If it's reality, you would think that we will all see it the same reality. Wouldn't you think that? But the reality is that we don't always see what we don't want to see. Have you ever seen a mess that you've created that you didn't really want to see the mess after you created it? It's like sometimes the messes that we create are too painful, so we want to turn away. I had the opportunity in 1999 to go to the Parliament of World Religions in Cape Town, South Africa. And it was after apartheid. Apartheid had ended. Nelson Mandela was the president of South Africa. And yet when we went to Cape Town, South Africa, it was the most soul tragic, difficult experience of my life to see that level of poverty that would happen through apartheid. To go to the townships, and if you've ever been to a township, so when we were there in 1999, their goal was to have running water every mile. That was their goal, was to have running water every mile, and they had to carry buckets or whatever they had, sometimes up to 5 miles in a township to get to running water. And the sewage was another bucket that they would take and throw into an open pit. When we would go to a restaurant in Cape Town, for security, they actually buzzed you in like a jewelry store. Because crime rate was so high, because the anger was so high at the life that people were being asked to accept. A visionary leader helps you see what you don't want to see. Even though you think your heart is going to break at looking at it, a visionary leader stands with you and gently points out what's wrong. Because until we can see it, we can't change it. And I bet there's things in your life. There's situation, there's conditions, there's relationships. There's things in your life that you just don't want to see anymore. That you pretend will just go away. And a visionary leader over and over points the light of it. Points the light on those situations. Because if we can't see it, if we won't see it, we can't heal it. And then a visionary leader invites us, the second part. It's a visionary leader invites us to see a possibility that our heart and our soul know, but that we've lost touch with. A visionary leader paints a picture with words often or images in such a way that you can see a possibility for your life and your world that's greater than you're currently living. And usually that vision is so great that we've lost touch with it. But every soul, when we come into this world, comes into this world with a vision of what could be. And there's a deep soul grief when the life that we're living doesn't match what our soul came for. I mean, sometimes we're seeing it in our children. When the souls of our children come into this world and the vision that they came, the vision that God gave them when they came into this world was so much greater than we're living, we see the heartache of our own children. Like, why is it this way? And a visionary leader is willing to articulate a vision over and over and over again until people can actually see it for themselves. Because sometimes we get so used to the way life is, believing in that much seems like fantasy. And yet God placed it in your soul for a reason. God placed it in your heart for a reason. So what's your greatest vision for life? What did your soul come for? What is that thing that you know in your heart of hearts that you came for in this life? Are you willing to lay hold of it again? Are you willing to take it on as your purpose? And then the third thing that a visionary leader does. And this is where it gets dangerous, right? Because it's actually easy to show people what is and invite them into another vision. But where it gets a little weird, where it gets a little dangerous, where it gets a little grinchy for folks, is when you invite them to believe in it. Because it's not enough just to have a vision for what could be if your beliefs don't allow you to see or believe that it's possible for you. If you don't have hope that that vision can become a reality, oftentimes we get angry, we get violent, we get ugly because we are mad at the person who made us remember our vision. If we don't believe that our vision is possible, we want to retaliate against that. So the number one thing a visionary leader has to do is help people believe that they can actually get there, that they wouldn't be given the vision by God if they weren't also given the ability through God to make that vision a reality. And over, a visionary leader has to help people believe, because without belief, there is no hope. And we see that in our society today. We see people that have a great vision of what their life could be, what our society could be, but we have this ledge, we have this ceiling, we have this thing that our mind says it's not possible. And the older we get, friends, the older we get, the more encrusted we become in our belief system. At your age, whatever your age is, you are more convinced you know how life works. Amen? You are more convinced that you know what's possible and what's not possible. And every year we get older, we tend to get more stuck in our own beliefs of what can be. But a visionary leader is willing to help people see that their mental trap is just their story. But it takes courage. It takes true courage to take people beyond what they've known, beyond what they see. And if we go into Scripture, we see the Israelites who were slaves in Egypt. And they spent 40 years wandering in the desert. 40 years. At that time, that was a lifetime. So the people that entered into the wilderness, by the time they went into the promised land, they were all dead. They were all gone. They were at least the second generation into the wilderness experience. And when you're the second generation, that's the life that you know. You didn't know slavery. You know wandering in the wilderness, and you don't yet know the promised land. You don't know the land that could be. And it actually takes a visionary leader to paint a picture of what the promised land could be so that you could believe in it enough to cross out of the wilderness into the promised land. And that's where we are today. We're having to decide as a people, as a nation, as a country, as a world, do we believe that our visions are possible? Because if it's not possible, let's just draw a line and say we can't move forward, we can't be better, we can't be more. This is it, so let's just suck it up and deal with it. I don't know if suck it up and deal with it was probably the most spiritual thing I've ever said. But I think, honestly, it's true. Today, where in your life are you being asked to be a visionary leader? And I know it would be great if somebody would come along beside you and do it for you. I know it would be great if somebody would save us from ourselves. But the truth is, it's we the people. Unfortunately, it's true. It's we the people. We are the people. This is our country. This is our world. This is exactly what we make it to be. No more and no less. The limitations that we sign off on are our limitations. The possibilities that we believe in and work for and make a reality are our possibilities. But it doesn't happen until we believe, until we can accept where we are, have a dream for where we can go, and believe that it's possible to get there. Because without that, we stay stuck. I want to close today by reading I Have a Dream. Because the reality is, when you hear these words that King spoke, what I believe that you will hear is all three elements of a visionary leader. He will clearly share the problem. He will share a possibility that is greater than most people believed when they heard these words. And he will invite you to believe. He will invite you into hope. Because without hope, we never move forward. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed, that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day the Red Hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners, will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherly love. I have a dream that one day, even in the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice and sweltering with the heat of oppression will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day in Alabama, with his vicious racist as governor, having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification, that one day, right there in Alabama, little black boys and little black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and little white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted, every hill and mountain shall be laid low. The rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed in all of its flesh, so that we shall see it together. It is our hope, it is our faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hem from out of the mountains of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we'll be able to transform the jangled discourses of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we'll be able to work together, pray together, struggle together, go to jail together, stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. With this day, and this will be the day, this will be the day when all God's children are able to sing with new meaning, "My country, 'tis of thee. Sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land where thy pilgrims' pride, with every mountain side, let freedom ring. And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. So that freedom will ring from the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire, let freedom ring from the mighty mountains of New York. Let freedom ring from the heightened Alleghenies in Pennsylvania. Let freedom ring from the snow-capped Rocky Mountains. Let freedom ring from the cavernous slopes of California. But not only that. Let freedom ring from the Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain in Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill in Mississippi. And every mountainside, let freedom ring. And when this happens, when we allow freedom to ring, when it rings from every village, every hamlet, every state, every city, we will be able to speed up the day when all God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing the words of the old Negro spiritual, "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty. We are free at last." Will you pray with me? I want you to open your heart with me. That we be inspired, each in our own way, to be a greater visionary leader. That we are no longer sitting on the sidelines waiting for somebody else. But that we be inspired in our own life, in our own family, in our own community, in our own world, in our own church, to be a visionary leader, to share a vision of what could be. God, use us. Speak through us. Help us shine a light on what is. Help us hold the vision of what could be, and help us give us the faith and the hope to make it a reality. This morning we stand in your light, God. And we desire a world where all people get to live in a world that works. In the name and through the power of the living Christ, we give thanks, and so it is. Amen.
Lead.
The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. And the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is.
Amen. earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God as Creator, family all are we. Let us walk with each other in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my joyous vow. To take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me.
God bless you, everybody. A great day and a wonderful week.